Nancy, I think it was, what was the word I used? It was the smartest opening we've had.
Yes.
Yeah. And the reason it was smart was because it was totally interactive. And Malika and Nancy were back there working their butts off, and everybody was trying out printmaking. And I think as this, yeah.
Yeah, we had a lot of people. We had a whole team.
And I think that art audience wasn't huge, but it was good.
Yeah.
And I think that it actually, for me, pointed me in a direction that I, with Fish Trap, was telling Nancy, it's sometimes hard to get writers to listen to one another. They're off writing their own little thing. What? And you know, in fact, Jim, when we started Fish Trap, we had to advertise that we were not a place to come if you wanted to get published. Right? We were a place to come if you wanted to talk to people about writing. But anyway, I loved the sharing on Saturday night and the interactive. And I love the idea that a painter can learn from a printmaker and a ceramicist that art is really, it is about communication and borrowing from each other and learning from each other. And I didn't know what we were getting into when I started this month. Cheryl just said, we've got to have some brown bags that relate to the program. And so I asked Nancy, and she said, well, I'm not an expert, but, you know, I've been, well, so what we, she's going to talk about her own journey. And her journey, it's another lesson for a lot of us here, that we can start things whenever we damn well please to start them, right? We don't have to begin them at the age of 6 or 8 or 9 or 11. We can start doing stuff and at any spot along the way. So Nancy and her husband Jim, they live up, they're part of the Lost Gene crew, but her career was in nonprofit health field. But I just learned today that her mother was an artist. But being of that era, had to, of course, put aside her art to raise her family. And I said, wouldn't ask the dad to put aside whatever the hell he was interested in to raise a family, would you? But anyway, and so there's that amount of art in her background, although she wasn't academically trained as an artist. Anyway, so Nancy's going to give us a little introduction to printmaking through her own journey.
Thank you, Rich.
Oh, she's on our board, too, by the way.
You guys are very nice to come and do this. When Rich said, would you do a brown bag on your journey, my first reaction was, heavens no, who would on earth be interested in that? It was about 20 seconds while he thought he was talking me into it, but actually what was playing through my head was, okay, Nancy, you have to say the words, I am an artist. You have to declare, I am an artist. Okay, you can do it. I am an artist. And so I'm going to stand up here. Thank you for the footstool. I'm going to stand up here. I'm an artist. Hyperventilate. and share. And so all of you are my friends. I'm so glad to see such a friendly audience.
That's in quotes, though, right?
No, it's not. So anyway, thanks for being here, and I will share a little bit. What I thought I would do is take just a little bit of time to sort of share my journey, the personal story, and then a little bit just to talk about the techniques of printmaking. I'm looking around and seeing we have a little bit of everything in level in terms of skill levels, and so I'll just walk you through a couple of what I do. And then if you want to, we could walk around the gallery and look at some of the specific ones, and I would do my best to tell you about those. So is that sound like a plan?
Yeah.
For people? All right. Well, jump right in. Let's make this collaborative. If I were going to actually have, you know, three key points, it would be anybody can make art and everybody should. You know, this has been my journey of getting very excited about all of this. A second theme for me would be about learning about this whole field of naive artists, untrained artists, outside artists, self-taught artist, folk artist, they don't say it anymore, primitive artist. You know, there's been a whole academic tradition about understanding this and studying all of this, and I put myself in that category, and it, to me, it's just the freedom to throw your hand and say, I can do anything I want, any way I want, and who cares if it's good? There are no editors. And if I can just turn on my own editor, we can all have a good time. And I think we saw that Saturday night with everybody just jumping in. And then the last theme that I would want to sort of talk about is that printmaking is an excellent, excellent place for beginners and for experts. You can come at it from so many different directions, and so I think that makes it great for a community art center like this, where we can have beginners and we can have very sophisticated artists and make printmaking part of it. So I hope I will generate some enthusiasm for those ideas with a little discussion here. So just a little bit about my own chronology. Yes, my mother was an artist, and she, hey, come right on in. So she was an artist. She gave it all up to raise kids. She did kind of, I will tell you the story that we had white paper and our friends had coloring books. And of course, we would go out and trade, and they would use my white paper and I would use their coloring books. I just did it out of spite. So there was a little bit of, you know, mom's guidance, but it wasn't a major part of our lives. I didn't really have any art training whatsoever until I did crafts with my nieces. And then about 12 years ago, I went to the Rufino Tamayo Museum of Prehistoric Art in Oaxaca. Anybody been there? So we were in Oaxaca, Jim and I were in Oaxaca doing a water system team, building water systems in these really remote villages, and we went into this museum. Tamayo is a wonderful Mexican artist, and he collected, you know, these antiquities that he would find. And in this case, there was this, it was about this big, and it was a ball court, it was a Mayan ball court, and had these little bitty Mayan figures all sitting around in the audience, and it had the little guys, you know, and the ball and the kicking, and we don't really know how they played the game, but, you know, here they are, you know, this wonderful little, you know, quotidian event from, did I say that word right? Quotidian, too many syllables, you know, event in this case. And so I went home, and just for fun, I got out some kids' clay, and I made a little diorama of our group doing our water thing, you know. And we, you know, there's Dexter sleeping on the tire, and, you know, this kid climbing the whatever. Anyway, and they really liked it. And so that was sort of fun, and I thought I was done. And then my wonderful, supportive husband found this stuff called friendly plastic. It comes in little balls, and so he gave it to me for Christmas, and you heat it up and it acts like wax, and you could shape it, you know. And so I started making nativity scenes. I've got, you know, in this tradition of European tradition where you make nativity scenes in your daily life, you know, with the manger is the, you know, your real barn and things like that. So I made a lot of those, but that was basically all the art I did. I got kind of a sense of humor with all of that. I had turtles trying on clothes and mermaids using shoes and stuff like that, but I wasn't very serious about it. But I really, in that process, got totally captivated with these two ideas. One of them is the naive, untrained, outsider artist, you know, who you don't have to come up through the ranks to make art. And then the other piece would be this, my interest in pre-Columbian art, which emerged on over into oceanic art and African art, and you know, all these things that are, to me, have a very, very strong narrative. They're always telling stories. You know, it's always about what's happening. They're not just odd, you know, special things to be put on the wall. They're part of your life. They're part of your religious life. And so, I went more and more places looking at all of these kinds of things, and I kept asking myself, well, what kind of a narrative does that tell me? How would I update that narrative? How can I bring that into something that I would do? So this was all just kind of fun until these same nieces that I did all this work with handed me this. This is an iPad, and my life was changed with an iPad. You know, she just said, here, Aunt Nancy, try this. And, you know, you can start, I'll show you in a minute, you know, you can work with your finger, you can do brushes and colors, and just, you know, it's so soothing and meditative, and you can push the undo button. It's gone, you know. How freeing is that, you know, for writers, artists, anybody, you know, they just undo, oh, it didn't matter, you know. So you can really let loose. So this is what really changed my life. I wouldn't give it back to her. And then once again, my support husband came along and got me my own iPad. So I really took to drawing, and I started, this was one of my early projects for drawing. This is called Scientists at Work. So these are technically digital pigment prints. So I drew all these girls, you know, 10, 11, 12, 13, doing their science experiments, you know, taxidermy on the parakeet, shaving the cat, dye in the swimming pool, entice the dog through the car wash, test gravity, get your little sister to test the battery, you know, put her tongue on the battery. So, you know, sense of humor, I'm going to pass this.
So around. You did all those on the iPad?
I did all of these on the iPad.
Would you call that again?
It's a pigment print because I took them down to Blix and I put them on a high quality paper using, they have special printers that use like a dozen inkjets, not just the usual. And that's what, and they're archival, so it will last, so I'll pass that around. But, so that was where I went first, yeah. And then the real magic happened when Jenny Clemza here, I retired, I went to Jenny's class in printmaking, and she said, jump in and try it. So I can put together, this is some pre-Columbian art. What is this one exactly? I saw this one at the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York. It is, I think it's open. Omec from Mexico, but I just love the couple, you know, they're, so intimate with each other, whispering, so I started with that, so I started with that, and then I said, I figured out how to carve it, and so I carved it on the linoleum. And this is called a linoleum reduction print, because you'll notice this doesn't look like that anymore, because after you do the first impression, you carve some more, and then you do some more, and do some more. And so then the fun part for me is, I said, so what's the story here? You know, how do I take this narrative from whenever that was, about, I think it's 600 years ago, and what would the story be now? Well, I decided the story was, you know, he's whispering sweet nothings in her ear, and then he's going to leave her. Maybe. So I made it as a diptych. There's two, so I put them together, and it's called Sweet Nothings.
I like the shitty grin. And then the frown.
Yeah, look at that. That's great.
So when you say reduction print, then you say that over again, because you don't just carve the whole thing and then print it. You said it was, you carve part of it and then you take part of it.
Right, and let me show you one of those.
So that linoleum printed it?
It did, in an earlier form. Okay, so you can see it still has black back here, and now I've cut this all the way.
Oh.
So what I did for this one is I cut, everything that's white, I cut away.
It's like and a positive rolled. And then negative. Uh-huh.
Yep, negative. And then I took a black ink and rolled it over the surface, and then put the surface onto a piece of paper. That's how it was made. Then I came back actually, and I didn't bring it with me, but I cut away some more, and I used some color, and then I lined it up perfectly and did it again about three times for a different edition.
So if you were going to do an edition of 10, you would have to do 10 all those, and then carve away, and then do that 10?
That's what Christy Wyckoff would do. Nancy makes 20 because she's going to put 10 in the trash can because she can't line them up straight.
But it really means that you're committing yourself to a certain amount of paper and effort and time and everything, and if everything screws up, they go in the trash can.
They go in the trash can, yeah. So that's actually one of the key characteristics of prints, is they're usually done, with one exception, usually done in editions. And you declare how big the addition's going to be. And if you're doing one like this where you can't go back, you know, once you've cut it off, it's gone, then you know what you're doing in advance, and you've got a plan for then adding each color as you go. I'm looking for one.
So it also makes it much more valuable.
Exactly, yeah, right. And after you've sold the first nine, that 10th one can go for $40, you know? That's when it all came together. Then the one more piece then in my story was, that's the lino cut, and then I did the AHA at Open Studios in Portland, when I discovered this thing called photopolymer intaglio, also known as solar plate. And what you can do with that then is take the art from here, turn it into a transparency, black and white, put it in a light box on a very special plate, and then bake an addition to prints. So let me show you how I really do that. Let me take this one. Right here. So, paper dolls. Right, this is one of the very first ones I did. Ted Hayes, bless his heart, bought it. made me feel really good. So with this one, I took, I'm going to show you on the iPad first. So this one doesn't use my pre-Columbian art, but where'd you go? He was up just a minute ago. One of the things you can do with iPad is draw, you know, in layers. So this one is where I started. I just took, I took a Greek sculpture, and I just kind of brought it in here and imitated it and drew this. Then I decided to do another layer, and I added an environment to her. So I added a cabin. Yes. So I added, you know, a cabin around her. And I said, well, you know, she might be in different environments, so I'm gonna also give her, you know, the bathroom. You know, so she's got a bathroom environment. And then she's also got, gave her a church as well. So now I've got my naked girl in the church, right? And then I said, well, I'm gonna put some clothes on her. And you know, here I've got her in her negligee. And then I've got her in some of her rabbit pajamas, you know. And I've got her in, you know, her nice dress as well.
So how did you add the clothing?
So I open a new layer, and then I would just draw some more. So turn them all off.
Saving the old one as it is.
Yeah, as is. That's good thinking.
So you get to draw with a special stylus?
I'm going to show you.
What's the name of the program?
So this is Procreate, which is my favorite. Brushes does about the same thing. You know, I felt really sheepish about doing this digital stuff until I realized that David Hockney, if you guys know David Hockney, is quite famous for the swimming pools, etc. This is all he does now, is this kind of art. His partner brings him his foam and a fresh bouquet of flowers, and he starts every day by drawing a new vision. So,
that's great. Thanks for being here.
Now we could.
The fonts and the ideas.
I can make it wider, I can pick different brushes. This one. I can change the colors. Okay, it's really fun. And as I said, watch this, undo, all right? So what I did with that, so now I've got them in layers, and then what I can do is print those separately and then end up with, I made six separate plates. I'm gonna pass this around so you see what a plate looks like. And I'm not gonna go into what solar plate is and then do it and all, but it's like etching, like a copper plate etching. So here's like the pajamas, pass this around.
It's like paper dolls.
Okay.
It's like paper dolls for sure, huh?
That's why I call it paper dolls, yeah. Here she is in her cabin, you know? So I made those plates, and then I ink them in two different colors. I line them up perfectly.
But you made the plates by digitally transferring that image to the...
It's about a four-step process. What you do is you put them on a black and white transparent, I mean, on black on a transparency, you put it in a light box.
Is that photographic? You take a photograph and...
You take a digital image. You can do a photograph, or you can just take a piece of plastic and draw on it. There's any way you can do it to have a black and white, a black and clear image. And then you use those special plates. They're coated with a water-soluble, light-sensitive coating. And then you use a light box and water.
How do you get it from the iPad to the negative?
Thumb drive.
You can go in.
But then you bring it someplace?
And I take it to Kinko's and they do it. You can do it on your own printer. Kinko's does a better job. Just putting it on a transparency,
and then you
make it. So then you end up with, so now I've got six plates. I made six plates. I've got the same body in three different places, in three different outfits, one dress, one pajamas, and one is skin. So then now I have one piece of paper, and I've got to line it up with three different plates, and run it through once, then line up three more plates, run it through the press again, and get them to all come out just right, and print called paper dolls. Does that kind of make sense?
Yeah. So is the press like the one you had down here?
Really?
That's the one I did them on.
So the registration is the key there.
Registration is key, yes.
Is that really hard to match up?
It takes practice. It just takes practice, and people have different ways of doing it. When we went to Crow Shadow, Frank Jensen is a master. He's built all these jigs, you know, for how he puts everything. I sometimes, when I did those, I would make these acetate things, and I would have them, you know, all lined up for where you put them. Now I mostly use the back of the paper, thumb drop, called a Japanese thumb drop, to put them in. So that's a little bit tricky, but it's just one of those skills that you master. It can go wrong with the registration. It can go wrong because it was over-inked or under-inked. It can go wrong because you picked the color that you didn't really like. There's a lot of ways. And then you can also get wonderful surprises. You know, oh, that's not what I had in mind. And that worked, so that's sort of, is that what I wanted to say about?
Nancy, you were saying you ran this like three or four times. Is that each color?
For that particular one, what I did was I made myself a jig of three, and so I had my three blacks, and then I had three outfits, and each outfit was a different color, so I only had to run it through the press twice. But I had to get three plates with each one. So six plates, six inkings, three lined up, run it through, three lined up, run it through. Does that make sense? Doesn't have to be that complicated. So I'm just going to show you a few for what I did. So I love updating the story. So on the back of these, you'll see what it is. So this is from Turkey, when my trip to Turkey. I loved this image of this woman at a theater. I'm not going to remember. Near Demre, D-E-M-R-E. Anyway, I loved her. So I said, she looks really freaked out. What would the story be if you were freaked out today? So I drew a face, And I said, well, the worst thing I could think of is a policeman comes to your door. Right? So this one is really just one color. It's just black. So that was pretty easy to produce. I drew that one on the iPad using its charcoal features and made it look like charcoal.
So you didn't try and reproduce her. You just redrew it using a similar expression.
Yeah, and but actually what I did for her, you can bring a photograph into Procreate, and I actually brought it in and then just drew around the outside of her face. All I have is her face, yeah. You know, and then shrink it down and say, okay, you know, then that's when you get to, what's she wearing? What's she doing? You know, who is this person and what's her story? This is another one from Turkey. These are in, where were these? The Selçuk Museum. They're late Roman Empire. It's like these two statues of busts, you know, heads basically. So I same thing, I loaded them to Procreate, I kind of did their faces and I said, okay, this is crumbling Roman Empire, right? What would be crumbling empire today? And I decided it's, you know, ICU in the emergency room. You know, the story of the two of them sitting there. So these are done with both intaglio and relief. So what I did was I did the etching for the black, and then I took a blue roller and rolled the blue roller over the top. So I only had to run it through the press once, and I got two colors.
So is it important for you to tell the backstory of these two, or do you usually just present the front part?
I've only been at it 3 years. I don't have a usually. Today, I'm giving the backstory, and I'll see if you all like it. If you do, I'll do it again.
So I don't see the blue on here, Nancy.
Uh-huh.
Where's the blue?
The blue, there's just a very light gray blue in the
back. Oh, okay.
It's a very subtle light front.
Yeah. I like your backstory.
The backstory?
Yeah. No, it's just really interesting, and I find it really creative how then you put a story to the front.
I like narrative, yeah. That's what I do. I worry a lot, and I worry about cultural appropriation,
yeah.
And when is it all artists are building on other people's work, and when is it okay and when is it not, and I think about that, and I worry, and I trust that if I'm doing it with respect, and I'm not making a lot of money off of it, I can do that. So those are two of the criteria.
I doubt they haven't copyrighted or anything.
I'm pretty sure they don't. You know, the artist is unknown for most of what I do. This one is, if you look at pre-Columbian art, you'll find this one very frequently in different outfits and clothing, but this is a very happy figure. And usually carrying a rattle. I saw this one at the Metropolitan Museum of Art. And so I said, so what's this person doing? Well, I changed the gender. And made it a karaoke singer.
Oh!
And called A Joyful Noise. I made about, what did I say, 7 of these, and they're all very different. So this is when you can start doing additional techniques. So the brown is the etching part. The yellow is a roll. Her dress is hand painted in, hand tinted. And for a bunch of them, I also did a stencil, and some of them I also did what's called sheen collé, which is I cut her out of a brown and made that for sort of a skin color. So, different ones for that.
So how long have you been at this?
I have been at this for 3 years.
Is that all?
That's when I took the first Josephy class and said, so I've been drawing on the iPad a little bit longer.
Monica tells me she was there.
I was there.
Yeah, you were there.
But where's your work, man? Next to you.
I'm
just using
the entire environment.
It's got very nice.
No, it's just you just came up.
Yeah,
you went to Portland and you had all that support there.
I worked in a collective studio, which is important because we could have a collective studio here.
Yeah.
And learn a lot from each other. You know, to Rich's point, printmaking is very collaborative. The tradition is that you help each other, you show each other, you do things together. You have an expert who runs the press, you have an artist who thinks things up. So it would be a really good thing for us to do and to be able to share all of that. I'm going to just pass.
Well, I made the point also that ceramics is much like that. That the people in the ceramic studio, you have a whole bunch of people who can't afford to buy their own kilt, or they're not going to buy their own wheel, or they like getting together with a glass of wine and
learning from each other.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's hard to do it individually. But all it's hard to do individually, but we have our special dates, kind of like having a walking friend.
Yeah.
You know, and it's like, oh, they're going to notice when I'm gone. And so they care and they're making art.
Yeah.
Oh,
wow.
This one is from also from Turkey. I just like this person. I don't know what that person was really doing, but they're thinking and they've got their thumb up. And so I turned it into a minor setback. You know, I really do like independent young girls that appeal to me. So that one was done with two plates, a brown plate and a yellow one. This is just to give you an idea of how, so this is a wonderful one. This is Aphrodite fixing her sandal. And so I updated, you know, well, obviously it's wearing your tennis shoes and heels, as all the city girls do. And so this gives you an idea of different techniques. So it's just the black is the etching. This one I did stenciling and rolls of different colored ink. And this one I did chinkalay. I cut her dress out of a piece of rice paper and glued it in there in between while I was doing the whatever. So it gives you an idea of lots of different places that you can take it. So what else would I tell you? Why is printmaking so much fun? Part of it is what we were just talking about is really collaborative. It's so varied. There's so many different ways you can go, so many techniques. There's a wonderful, Christy Wyckoff made a great handout of it over there on the pedestal. For different printmaking terms, I've got a simpler one here that I think I'll hand out. Are you guys, do you want this? Do you want to know about what the different kinds of prints are?
I know. It would be interesting for you to go around and tell us how these were done.
Is this the one?
No, this is a simpler one-page one.
Simpler.
So if you would like that, what I'll do, I'll just take a few minutes and I'll go through this and tell you what these are and just kind of high level of what the kinds are. And then we'll go around and point. Does that give you some time? Okay. So the key pieces are, the key kinds are relief, all right? This guy, wherever you went, the linoleum guy is a relief. That means you cart away what you don't want, and then you ink the surface of what's left, and you're using the top part. That's a relief print. All those Japanese prints that you see, there's beautiful, beautiful, you know, the wave, Mount Fuji, those are all carved in wood and rolled on the surface. I think there's a maximum, 78. Sometimes they'll use as many as 78 different blocks of the different colors, you know, to make them. And they have people that just specialize in blue. So those are relief prints. You carve away what you don't want and ink the top. So the other big bucket is intaglio, which is Italian just for bite, I think. And it's the opposite. You're removing what you do want. So you take your plate and you're removing stuff from this down into it. And that's what you want to keep. And you can either do it with a sharp tool. The biggest way to do it is with acid, dropping it and protecting pieces of it and dropping it in an acid bath on top of the plate. Mine is light and water.
What do you protect it with?
I protect it with this black stencil.
The chemical, the acid.
On an acid one, you use a rosin, and it acts kind of like a wax, and you cut all of, you coat it with that, and then you carve away the parts that you do want. Our acid etching experts back here in the corner.
And I'm going, yeah, you got it. Except it's not necessarily carved. You can't carve the. So when you say carving, you're using a technical term. That's the only thing. It's really gentle.
It's
more of a gentle carving. I don't know if you've got to do that one yet. But, I mean, I see, obviously, you're doing all this beautiful stuff.
But did you guys get to do any of that, just how subtle it is
yet? It's very subtle,
yeah.
So you're like penetrating the wax layer?
Yeah, just
exactly.
A tiny subtle wax layer. And then the difference would be, you know, you can do it all black and then burnish out what you liked of the white,
mm-hmm.
so then it turns back. But Nancy has all this, I mean, she's tapped it, she's moved beyond all that. But that it's kind of, they're big about the Italia being, it has to be set numbers of, you know, layers and addition. You have like 8 times to burn it in acid or the bite will erode. So it lends to itself of being, I think the solar plates are really interesting because there's a lot more subtlety to it, isn't there?
With the solar plate, you can do it in one shot, but
yeah.
You can't fix it.
Ah.
Copper.
Yeah, with copper
you,
and
you have to do several, you know, I want a gray, well, I'm going to do a little less. Well, I want black, well, I'm going to leave it in the copper a long time, mm-hmm. acid a long time. And if you didn't quite like it right, you can burnish it back out and dip it back in the acid. So that's the difference. And then the Christie's handout, you can go a million directions with the acid. You can do resin pellets. You can do water pushes on, you know, so you can get a lot of subtle textures in there as well. And there probably are people here who have done more plate etching than I have. If you want to do that. Yeah, feel free to chime in if you want to tell people how to do this. but the main thing was the Italia, you've dug it in to the plate, and if you ran your finger over that, you can barely feel it. And then that's what holds the ink. So you rub the ink in, and then you wipe the surface super clean, leave it in the pits, and then you use wet paper. And then this is when you really, really need the press to push it in there and pull that ink out of those little cracks.
Mm.
That makes sense? Mm-hmm. With the wood cut, you don't need, or the lino cut or the wood cut, you don't need a whole lot of pressure. I was just showing folks earlier. This is George Johansson. He has one of my favorites. He has a press over there on the wall. He does all lino cuts, and he uses a kitchen spoon. He just put it, he's, you know, taped a little weight into his kitchen spoon, and he rubs that over the surface. Yeah, so it's really a gentle.
Oh, so by using the weight rather than his own pressure of his hand,
it's even. It's even, exactly. He's built a fancy jig so that he can line it up with a whole bunch of times. With the spoon, yeah, that's how Jenny taught me, with the wooden
with
kitchen
the
spoon.
Oh,
yeah.
And I've done that. Did you find it was hard to get even pressure? Or is it more natural to get pressure?
I didn't do it enough to actually be able to tell you. I think the critical thing is that inks vary a lot, and so you really have to learn your ink. One of the other things I would say about printmaking is you can go totally non-toxic, which is another good thing for a community art center. I use a brand called Akua. It's made out of honey and soy, and it washes up with water.
Other than me eating it all the time. Where's the tank? Oh, stick your tongue out. Yeah, peanut butter and a coup is surprisingly good.
Yeah.
What color do you like?
And that's all really exciting for here because we can do the non-toxic Italio acid, but then you take the oil prints out, it's just upgraded. So you're bringing that all to the table of like modernizing that last step. So that's, thank you.
They're good. They're really fun inks. You know, there's some purists won't use them, but people at Print Arts Northwest will sit there and tease each other about it, you know, because there's some very, very good artists that only use Akuma now because they care about their health and the environment.
Yeah.
What acid are you using? I mean, is it like vinegar?
No, I have a whole series of books of it, but it's basically mild down. But then they've also they started in 90, I think it was 97 is the first time anyone used a non-toxic acid that it could be dropped down the sink. It can technically, I think around here, we would still want to be respectful of, like if Nancy wanted to do an Italia, I told her we'll still go outside, you know, and treat it like oils,
mm-hmm.
but it's not more toxic than oils. And it's just, it's the same acid, but it's just diluted down in such a small, and I think it's a result of the plate change as well.
Yeah, you change the metal, you can change the acid. Do you know what kind of acid group you're using on copper?
The kind I used in school was
Absolutely not, not like it was really powerful. And like, if you left a plate in there longer than like an hour, it's basically wrecked. Yeah, like, it was really just a lot.
So you're still using hydrochloric acid?
Yeah, it was straight. Yeah.
And so that was pretty new in Canada, actually. In 90, it was just 97 where you could put it down the drain. If you're set up properly. Of course, we wouldn't do that here, but you know, in this, but anyway, it's just really toned down. I think it's the changing of the zinc is primarily the zinc, you know, the zinc to versus copper.
And that's why we need collaborative
work,
because we teach each other all this stuff.
That's right.
Yeah.
Are you saying you use zinc plates for that diluted acid?
Hmm?
Is that what you're saying, that you wouldn't use copper plates for a diluted acid wash?
You don't have to, you can. With the kind of plates that I'm using, no.
Well, yeah, you're doing the solar.
I'm doing the solar, yeah. Yeah. With the copper ones, we'll have to talk to the other experts on that.
I would assume that would take a lot longer.
Yeah.
We lay out all the goods and see what we have.
See what we have. Yeah. See what we want to invest
in.
So quickly, the other types of relief and intaglio are the two great big buckets. And within intaglio, you get many, many, many different kinds. And Christie's will go on about aquatints and mesotints and all that other kind of stuff. The other big category is planographic, which is where you don't, you know, one is you're carving away, leaving the surface. The other is you're carving down and putting going in the cracks. This one is you're not changing the surface. You're not doing either of those. You're keeping the surface, but you're managing the surface in different ways. So the biggest one is lithography, where you take a gigantic rock and you put grease on it and non-grease, and the water repels certain places and the ink does the other one. I'm not going to explain it because I can't and haven't done much. But the other one is that we do a lot of in this category is monotypes. And that's what Kirk was demonstrating. On Saturday night, if you were watching Kirk roll the ink on a plate and then he was wiping away. You can also roll, you can poke, you can do all kinds of things. And one of the ones that our kids might love is jelly plates, where you have this kind of this gelatin plate. You just basically take acrylics and paint whatever you want on it, and then rub it with the paper, with a press or a brayer, and then all that ink transfers upside down to the paper. So that's another really fun one to do. That one is called a monoprint because you only get one. It's unique. You can't do it again. And so that, unlike all the other kinds, you don't get additions of monoprints. Then there's the whole category of screen printing, which we won't even go into, but that's one where you're basically using a stencil and squeezing ink through the stencil places on a screen and then onto, a lot of times screen printing is done on fabric. Takes to that technique very well, so we can do some t-shirts. There are solar screens as well, yeah. And then, is this said calligraphy or calligraphy?
Oh, I've heard it both ways.
Oh, thank you.
Out west, everybody has like a little enunciation twist too.
Okay.
So I don't know if it's regionalism, but both ways have been, I've been.
All right, well that's where I got started. Jenny taught us how to make those, and she's having a class next weekend doing it, if you wanted to try it. Mm-hmm. David was demonstrating these on Saturday night. He was using little pieces of tape to make a plate, you know, so that makes your surface come up, and then you coat you run a roller over the top, hit the top of your textures, and then transfer those to paper. And then pigment prints is the digital process where you use some sort of either photography or drawing like I do, and create your image and then use a special kind of ink and special kind of printers on high quality paper and make an archival digital print, which is really more, you know, blurring the lines between what's a photograph and what's a print and what people say, and the experts can argue about all that stuff. We can hear it, just makes pretty things. So,
you said one thing earlier about taking something to Blick.
Blick.
Is there a Blick over in Portland?
Yes, there's a Blick in Portland. You can ship your files digitally to them. They'll print for you and then mail them back to you. They're a great drain on my bank account. We find so many things that we
So do you want to walk around a little bit and point in a few pictures? Do you guys have time for that? Would that be worthwhile? Okay, let's do that just a little bit. Let's start.